Russian historians, as my friend Alexei Miller, define politics of history in general as history used exclusively by Putin for his political purposes and strategies. But I would like to argue that historians, being members of civil society, also contribute in one way to another, directly or indirectly, to politics of history and politics of memory, in choosing certain topics which are politically and ideologically related to the present. The political or cultural context of our own biography is also often interconnected with the choice and interpretation of our topics and of our sources. To make it clearer, I belong to a generation of Western students of Russian and Soviet history who thought during the period of the Cold War, perhaps very naively, that in choosing historical topics which were ignored by Russian colleagues or even forbidden to be treated by Soviet ideology, that we could contribute to establish historical truth, or less pathetically, with the words of the German 19th century historian Leopold von Ranke, wie es eigentlich gewesen ist, how it essentially was, meaning that we could do bring to history objectivity, or the presentation of history objectivity. We did not realize then that notwithstanding our idealism or good intentions, some of our topics were directly or indirectly influenced by the larger context of the Cold War as it was experienced by Western societies. During this year of 2018, we remember particularly in France, but also in Germany and the United States, the 50th anniversary of the 68 students' revolt. We had two remarkable discussions about this here already. In those times, students who wanted to change our capitalist societies were very often influenced by socialist and Marxist thoughts. We also remember this year in Western societies, more than in yours, the 200th anniversary of the birth of Karl Marx. And last but not least, we remember the Warsaw Pact invasion and occupation of Czechoslovakia in August 68. Socialism with a human face, the slogan created by Dubček, was directed against the centralism of the Communist Party, its abuse of power, the lack of freedom and democracy. Socialism with a human face, as opposed to Soviet Stalinist Marxism, became a slogan for an entire generation of Western leftist intellectuals to which I belong. By the way, Mikhail Gorbachev entitled an article written on November 27, 1989, Socialism with a Human Face, in which he defined his reform program. It was to a certain degree our interest in a reformable socialism and humanist Marxism. We took as an example the young Marx, but not the Marx of the Kapital, but most of all in our interest was in the cultural building of the young Soviet state of the 20s, that some Western historians, to which I belonged, became fascinated by the most original Russian Marxist philosopher and social theorist, Alexander Bogdanov, whom I mentioned already, whose memory was totally discredited or even forbidden in the Soviet Union. Building up together with Lenin the Bolshevik fraction of the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party. He became a major rival of Lenin about the leadership in the Bolshevik center, a kind of central committee, after the revolution of 1905. Through maneuvers, Lenin excluded him from the Bolshevik center in 1909. The same year, he wrote Materialism and Empirical Criticism against Bogdanov's unorthodox understanding of Marxism, a text which had to be read by all Soviet students of history, philosophy, and other disciplines until the very end of the Soviet Union. When at the end of the 70s, a correspondence between Maxim Gorky and Alexander Bogdanov and some other major figures of the early Bolshevik intelligentsia, they called themselves Partinnye Literati, literati taken from the German word, that means people who were doing propaganda, writing leaflets for the party. A correspondence between Bogdanov and Gorky and Lunacharsky, Pokrovsky, Skvortsov-Stepanov, Bazarov, Krasin, and other later prominent Bolshevik members was discovered in Paris, which contained also some letters of Trotsky to Bogdanov and Gorky. I was asked to edit them. The request came from a Roman socialist senator whose foundation had acquired the documents and wanted to publish them in Italy. In those years, Italy had an influential communist party known for its political openness, in other words, Euro-communism, which included many important Italian intellectuals. Their interest in the Russian emigration on Italian soil for Russian literature and culture, and last but not least for Russian Marxism, was very profound at that time. And the publication of this correspondence promised to be of great public interest. Insofar, the documents showed the early stage of Bolshevism, and in particular the first generation of the Bolshevik intelligentsia, who disputed the identity of Bolshevism already 4 or 5 years after its foundation. Maxim Gorky, as you know, had spent many years before the Revolution 17 at Capri, exactly 1906 to 1913, and in the 20s, when he was more or less expelled by Lenin to leave the country because of his critical opinion of the follow-ups of the revolution, he was living from 22 to 33 in Sorrento, the island of Sorrento. 33, he returned to the Soviet Union. Bogdanov had lived after he was expelled from Russia after the Five Revolution to 13 in Geneva and Paris, the big centers of the Russian emigration. When I wanted to consult Gorky's long years in Italy to find out how he was perceived by the Italian state authorities, I went to the National Archives in Rome. But the Gorky dossier, the Gorky papka, was totally empty. But it was still there, written Massimo Gorky, empty. An Italian minister president had offered it to the Soviet leaders on a visit to the Soviet Union, without making any excuses to the archives or even giving a note what was in this papka and so on. In the Soviet Union, these archival materials were, of course, inaccessible because they showed Gorky's very friendly relation not only to Bogdanov, but also to other Russians whose names were taboo in the Soviet Union, and they showed Gorky's almost hatred of Lenin's kind to interpret Bolshevism in the years after 1905. Gorky, as you know, or your parents knew, or grandparents, was not only considered the greatest Soviet writer, a convinced communist and inspirer of socialist realism, his friendship with Lenin was elevated to a myth upheld until the very end of the Soviet Union. The center of the Bogdanov archival holdings, which was found in Paris, consists, among other documents, of 65 letters written by Gorky to Bogdanov. They concern the political, cultural, and philosophical projects developed by the so-called left Bolsheviks, a term coined by Lenin in 1908 for the Bogdanov group, which in its final incarnation became an alternative to Lenin's concept of Bolshevism, namely a strong party organization. Bogdanov and his group, with Lunacharsky, Maxim Gorky and others, opposed Lenin's authoritarian party Bolshevism, the party organization as it was written or explained in Studiology. They argued for a concept favoring the education of white groups of workers. They should acquire a socialist class consciousness, and their own culture, proletarskaya kultura, before the revolution would take place. Otherwise, the achievements of the revolution would fall immediately into the hands of the party elites, people like Lenin. In this circle, political cultural ideas of Bolshevism were directed against Lenin's reduction of Bolshevism to strong party politics. It was in this context, by the way, that Lunacharsky, the future People's Commissar for Education, the head of the Nachkompros, used the term Leninism for the first time. This was in 1908, as being identical with Lenin's authoritarianism and individualism. To give you an example of Gorky's attitude towards Lenin in these years, which the Soviet authorities wanted to ignore because of reasons of politics of history, I'm quoting in my bad Russian from a letter which Gorky addressed to Bogdanov and his wife in June 1909, just after having read Lenin's Materialism and Empirical Decision. Получил книгу Ленина. Начал читать и с тоской бросил его к чёту. Что за нахальство? Не говоря о том, что даже мне, профану, его философические экскурсии напоминают, как это не странно, Шарапова и Ямокина. Это были политические консервативные журналисты с их изумительным знанием всего на свете. Наиболее тяжкое впечатление производит тон книги, хулиганский тон. Итак, таким голосом говорят с пролетариатом. И так воспитывают люди нового типа, творцов новой культуры. Когда заявление «Я марксист» звучит как «Я Рурикович», не верю я в социализм марксиста, не верю. И слышу в этом крике о правоверии своем ноты того же отчаяния погибели, кое столь громко в вехах и подобных нагробных рыданиях. Все эти люди, взывающие городу и миру, я марксист, я пролетарий, и немедля вслед за ним садящиеся на головы ближних, харкая им в лицо, противными, как взякие бары. Каждый из них является для меня мизантропом, развлекающим свою фантазию, как их поименовал Лесков. Человек дрянь, если в нем не бьется живое сознание связи своей с людьми, если он готов пожертвовать товарищеским чувством, самолюбию своему. Ленин в книге своей таков. Его спор об истине ведется не ради торжества ее, а лишь для того, чтобы доказать, я марксист. Самый лучший марксист – это я. Как хороший практик, он ужаснейший консерватор. Истина незыблема. Это для всех практиков необходимое положение. И если им сказать, что, мол, относительно всякая истина, она взбирается, чтобы небогуд не чувствует колебания почвы под ногами. Но беситься можно и добросовестно. Ленину это не удалось. В его книге разряженный публицист, а философа нет. Он стоит передо мной, как резко очерченный индивидуалист, охраняющий прежде всего те привычки мыслить, кон насладили его «я» известным образом и навсегда. Безнадежный человек. Вероятно, и на практике он теперь будет и хуже, и хуже. Вообще, бесчисленное количество грустных мыслей вызывает его работа, нерашливая, неумелая, бесталантная. When I published this letter in 1970 or 80, in a very professional journal, nevertheless, it was like a bomb. And the director of the IMLI, the Institute of World Literature, in the name of Maxim Gorky, wanted to meet me in person in Paris to go get hold of this letter and other letters by Gorky and Lunacharsky, who were written in the same tone with the leitmotif, Lenin doesn't understand anything of Bolshevism. Of course, even if I would have liked to give this letter to the director of the IMLI, I couldn't have done it. It didn't belong to me. It belonged to a foundation. But this gentleman, as a director of archives, he would know very well that a private person who is charged to edit letters cannot sell them or give them away. He tried everything to persuade me without any success. In social democratic party schools, which were organized with the help of Maxim Gorky on Capri, where he lived because of his tuberculosis, and later in Bologna, Bogdanov's concept of proletarian culture, proletarskaya kultura, was developed, which became, in summer of 17, the basis of the independent movement of Proletkult, and which played, as you know, a major role in the first years after the October Revolution. Other projects, these Bolsheviks who were interested in developing a proletarian culture, was to create a huge proletarian encyclopedia, putting together all the knowledge accessible to workers, as the French had published in the 18th century the knowledge of the bourgeoisie in the Grand Encyclopedia. Another project was a proletarian university, all ideas of Bogdanov, which became partially at least realized after 17. The concept most discussed by the group around Bogdanov and Gorky during their emigration was collectivism, as opposed to Lenin's individualism and authoritarianism, which in the 20s as you know, became the key concept of the constitution of the new man of the new Soviet world. For my publication of Gorky's letters to Bogdanov, Bogdanov answers to Gorky, which were all in Soviet archives, would have been extremely crucial. But no question of getting hold of them during Soviet times. Bogdanov's relation to Gorky was kept secret. In the 1990s, when the archives were at least partially opened, Gorky was still a sacred figure in the Institute of World Literature of the Academy of Sciences, which conserved Gorky's archive and edited his work, his letters, until this day. Its trustees were not willing, by the middle of the 90s, after Perestroika, to let a Western scholar examine the Bogdanov letters in their possession, as they showed Gorky's intimate intellectual relationship with Bogdanov, which came at the expense of his officially celebrated unbreakable friendship with Lenin. Such ideological deconstruction had already begun in mass media during Perestroika, but the IMLI officials were reluctant to admit it. The senior official at the Gorky archive still pretended by the middle of the 90s that Gorky had had no contact with Bogdanov. The other and far more important part of Bogdanov's personal archive was, until its dissolution, located in the Central Party Archive of the Institute of Marxism-Leninism. Trying to get access to it in the 90s, I accepted an invitation from the directors of the Institute of Marxism-Leninism to give a talk on Bogdanov. To my great astonishment, they were not only very well acquainted with the thought of Bogdanov, but discussed some arguments which I discovered as being my own ones. I had in the meantime published quite a few articles on Bogdanov, and most of all a big chapter in Italian history of Marxism in 5 volumes called Bolshevism na Rasputye, Bogdanov I Lenin. When I asked them about this coincidence that they had such a profound good knowledge, one of the directors of the Institute Marxism-Leninism published a save and showed me, almost with a certain pride, all my publications on Bogdanov and Gorky translated into Russian for eternal use. Nobody knew this in Russia, it could not have been published, but they knew this, and they knew it very well. We had a very fruitful and interesting discussion, but the access to Bogdanov's letters to Gorky was still refused to me. Only quite a few years later, when the Institute Marxism-Lenin was dissolved and its archive converted into the Rossiyskiy Gosudarstvennyy Arkhiv Sotsialno-Politicheskoy Istoriy, the GASPI, and when the IMLI got a new director, I got access to Bogdanov's answers to Gorky, which I needed so much for my definite publication, under the condition, of course, of an exchange with the copies of the Gorky letters to Bogdanov from the Italian Fondazione Lello Basso, which was done. So, to our main question, politics of history? In those years of the 90s, the director of Russian archives were already relatively free to dispose of their materials. Quite a few publications by Russian and Western historians working in common were issued. For instance, an extremely important publication of documents on the peasant policy of the communist, the collectivization by the Russian Danilov and my French colleague and friend Lena knows him, Alexei Perelovich was published. But these major institutions of Soviet ideology, as the IMLI and the Institute of Marxism-Leninism, still stuck voluntarily to their political dogma in times where they easily could have freed themselves from it. Literaturnaya Gazeta, by the way, had suppressed the Gorky emblema from its first page and replaced it by the one of Pushkin. In the meantime, the IMLI celebrated Gorky's 140s and 150s anniversaries in 2008 and this year with greatest pomp, when the Russian public had already distanced itself almost entirely from Gorky. The leading elderly Gorky specialist at the IMLI celebrates him now as a profoundly religious man and reconsiders his novel Match, in Soviet times the predecessor of socialist realism, as Evangelie Novoi Veri. In the meantime, also the Literaturnaya Gazeta took up again the emblema of Gorky on its first page. Some days ago, I received an invitation from the Russian embassy in Paris to participate in a conference debate on Gorky's humanism, organized by the delegation of the Russian Federation at UNESCO. Thus, Gorky, whose enthusiasm for Soviet labor camps was already unmasked by Solzhenitsyn in his Gulag Archipelago, when he described Gorky visiting the Solovki and favoring the construction of, Bielomor Canal, and Gorky's whose exchange of letters with Stalin was discovered and partially published in the early 19th century, Gorky seems to be rehabilitated from higher political instance. My book, as Andrei nicely mentioned, has finally appeared in Italy. It's a long book with almost 1,000 pages, because in those years where I didn't get access to Soviet archives, I looked up Russian archives in our Western world, for instance, the Bakhmetyev archives in New York, where Russian emigres after 17 and most of all after the Second World War had sold their archival materials because they needed money. And because, and this brings me again to politics of history, in the years of the Cold War, our Western universities, and most of all the ones of the United States, but also of Western Germany, were interested in studying Russian and Soviet history to know the enemy. So there are quite a few of Western archives who has had some things to do with my correspondence, which now went into unfortunately an Italian edition, which nobody reads, because almost no Slavist in this world reads Italian. Perhaps they read French, but still. But it had to be in Italian because of the Italian foundation and the engagement it took. Russian edition by Novoi Literaturnaya Obezreni is on the way. My conclusion, politics of history, as well as public history and public memory, relate not only to politicians, but also to journalists and many other members of civil society, such as us historians in the first line, but also to teachers, to professors, to archivists, to directors of museums and creators of expositions and many others who bring their different interests and knowledge, but also sometimes their strategies into the process of politics of history. Having focused my talk on my personal Soviet and post-Soviet experiences with Gorky and Bogdanov, I do not ignore at all that my and quite a few of other Western historians' interest in Bogdanov's opposition to Lenin, in his alternative to Lenin's conception of party organization and party authority, was linked to the Zeitgeist, to the Durchwremeni of the Cold War, to the anti-communist which characterized Cold War in a time even those who were not anti-communist, we were in some way influenced by these topics. The question I draw from my experience and the question I always try to transmit to my students, how do we as historians relate to the same materials, sources, topics at different stages of the Durchwremeni or of the historical political evolution in and how our own intellectual, if not political or ideological evolution is not directing our look at history. How do changing political and ideological perceptions, representations, interpretations influence our so-called objective scholarships and perhaps also our methods? With this little personal experience, I want to underline, as a tiny little member of the huge civil society to which I belong, perhaps in France, in Germany, or in both countries, I contributed in a good, in a bad sense, but I contributed to politics of history, if I wanted or not. And it is in this sense I would like to conclude and ask you if you have experiences, probably not personal, but from your parents and from your grandparents, which go perhaps in the same directions, that they looked at historical events, historical figures such as Maxim Gorky, but it could be also Shostakovich or somebody else, and it perhaps goes a little bit further than the discussion which you had after Jeffrey Hoskins' excellent contribution, to ask more directly to which degree your knowledge of history is linked to your perception of yourself as a member of civil society. Blagodaju vas za vnimanje.